10,000 in men's fund, I put 50% in equity and in debt instruments.
Okay, should he break up that 10,000 in equity and debt is what his question is. For someone investing 10,000, would you say an SIP route works, or is it too small an amount to go in for an SIP?
10,000 is on an annual basis, if I'm correct. Is right. Devang, that's what you said, right?
Right, he is okay. Talking about an annual basis.
Right, okay. So if it's an annual basis, yes, then you know, you can't really do an SIP, because the minimum investment in an SIP is a 500 in some schemes, which is kind of going out. Mostly it's going to be about 1,000 rupees a month. What I would say is, I think you're on the right lines where you're saying that you should invest in two separate schemes, one being equity and one being debt. If you want to do a 50-50 equity and debt, maybe you could, you know, choose two different funds, and over a period of time, at the end of say 1 year or so, you look at it and, you know, maybe reallocate your portfolio so that you're more or less at the same level of asset allocation, that is 50-50 as you desire.
Okay, but would you say debt is really something one should invest in right now? Dismal returns at best in the last couple of years. A new investment in debt right now would be a good idea?
Right. See, what happens with debt is it's more driven by the kind of risk tolerance capability that one individual has. So if I do not want to take a call more than, you know, 50 or 60% into equity, then with the remaining amount, if I have to invest in a mutual fund, then, you know, the best option is to maybe go into a debt fund, and within a debt fund, maybe look at a floating rate fund, which does not, you know, which is a little bit, so to say, shielded from the volatility of interest rates.
Okay, we slip into a break now, but Karthik Zaveri stays on to answer more queries. Don't go away. Welcome back to Your Money. We're talking about saving, investments and strategies today. Next online with us is Nidhi Nagendra. Nidhi, how are you doing?
I'm fine, thank you. What about you?
I'm fine. Where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Bhopal.
Okay. Nidhi, what can we do for you and how do you plan? I see here you're a freelancer. Does that make it even more difficult to plan investments?
No, that's not. But I'm basically concerned about my husband's tax saving options. Means my basic concern is how can I plan my investment so as to get the maximum tax advantage? Means what are the various tax saving options for me?
Tax and advantage question, for you or for your husband?
For my husband, obviously. Okay. And the second question is that my husband is getting fee, not the salary. He's acting a consultant to an NGO, an international NGO. So what he is getting is a fee. So what are the various tax dimensions if my husband is getting a fee?
Okay, so she wants to save or invest from solely the purpose of saving tax. Karthik, how can we help her? And first off, any investments she makes, will they give any kind of tax benefit to her husband?
No. That wouldn't happen. Her husband would have to make investments out of his own earnings, and that's the only way you can get a tax break onto your investments, into your savings. Let's look at the second part first. I mean, what other things she can do besides this tax saving? She did mention something about that, and, you know, given that her husband is getting a fee, a consulting fee, and not really a salary, there are other advantages that he gets as a business person, which is things like depreciation and if he has staff salaries and things like that, which he can offset from his business income, because this is exactly a business income and not really a salary that he's getting. Now let's say, Nidhi, coming to your question of how can he save his taxes, according to the new Section 80C, he's going to be able to invest 1 lakh into a variety of instruments, which is going to give him almost 30,000 rupees of tax breaks. These instruments effectively are your ELSS and your LIC policies and your pension policies, etc. But there are two things that you need to consider when you actually set out to start this kind of an investment strategy for your husband. One is you need to look at the kind of instruments that you are going to take, and, you know, are you going to be comfortable with the kind of risk these instruments will have inherent in them, right? Because there is one angle of taxation. Some instruments like infrastructure bonds and NSE are not so much tax friendly now, because you'll have to pay tax. The interest that you get from that will be added to your income, though you get a tax break on the face of it. So then the choice remains into going like to instruments such as equity linked saving schemes, unit linked insurance plans, insurance policies, etc. So that's one choice that you first need to make. And the second thing is, you know, we're not very sure about the kind of taxation that's going to happen on insurance and PPF funds, because we're talking about something called an EET regime. It's going to come in shortly. There's a committee who's working on that. So my guess is that, you know, by the next financial year or so, there would be some announcements regarding a taxation on.
But you know, that's something a lot of viewers talk about or ask us about. An EET regime, wouldn't it be from a prospective effect and not a retrospective effect? If someone is planning to make investments now or today, should they be worrying about it?
See, Tamanna, what happens is, though it's going to happen prospectively, it's like this. Your insurance funds and your PPF policies are effectively very long-term policies or long-term instruments, shall we say. It's about 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. So what happens if the government says that whatever funds you will get on redemption, you might have to pay, say, a 10% or a 15% or some marginal tax on that? Well, we're not really sure. It can, you know, go both ways. You could have some kind of a tax break coming only on the funds that you will make investments, say, 1st April 2006. So it could go either ways. What I'm saying here is not to invest, but go a little easy into these investments, because there are alternative options which give you better yields and which are a part of the same ATC section, under which you're going to get an exemption for 1 lakh of your investments.
Right. One more interesting thing, Ketan, is that both of them are, I wouldn't say freelancers, but they're not salaried employees. That means they don't have a specific amount of money coming in every month. Is there a need for a different kind of savings planning and investment planning for such people?
What they can do is, again, you know, a lot of this revolves around the kind of instruments they choose. Let us, for example, choose that, you know, they chose an equity linked savings scheme. Now, that's obviously a risky proposition. Now, if they had to do that, they're not going to be able to do on an SIP on a monthly basis. They can do it on a quarterly basis or a triannual basis. Over a period of time, what happens is the volatility eases out. As long as you know that this is a long-term investment and you have to have a time frame of at least about 5-7 years, you should be perfectly okay. If you're talking about other instruments as a part of ATC, then of course, you know, this doesn't really matter so much. You put in the money as in how you have it.
Okay, let's go across and talk to Manoj Rajput. He's calling us from New Delhi. Manoj, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much for calling me.
You're welcome. What can we do for you?
Okay, I have a question. I'm a regular viewer of your program. Let me advise you. I'm at the age of 32 years.
Okay.
And I'm a public sector employee.
Okay.
I invest around 80,000 rupees per year in my PPF and my LIC and my PF accounts. My question is that if I want to go for the mutual funds, how beneficial it is to go for the mutual funds, because I don't need a big amount for next 3 to 10 years period. Please advise.
Okay. Now, when you're saying how beneficial, you're talking about in terms of returns, in terms of liquidity, or in terms of safety?
In terms of return, because regarding the safety, I have other investments I have. So now the concerns regarding the returns.
Right. And if you're looking at this purely from a tax saving angle, then in that 1 lakh umbrella, he has about 20,000 rupees left to invest in other instruments. If we're just talking about tax, but you know, overall, how much do you want to put in mutual funds right now? What is your investable surplus?
My idea is to invest around 40 to 50,000 apart from my investments to the mutual funds yearly.
Okay. Karthik, how can we help him? Say about maybe 20,000 is what he has in that whole 1 lakh umbrella. Some money, do you think, should go into ELSS schemes?
Definitely. He doesn't need any money for the short term. He mentioned 3 to 7 years is a fairly long period of time to have, and which is correct in terms of the investment into an equity kind of an instrument. So yes, that's a good idea. Going forward, the 40 to 50 thousand that he said he wanted to invest, again, you could do a mix of mutual funds. What you could do is you could look at diversified funds, you could look at mid-cap funds, and allocate a certain percentage, say about, you know, 20 to 30% diversified, maybe another 20-30% into mid-caps. And again, if you're happy to do a little bit more aggressive funds, you could invest your remaining 10 to 20 thousand, which is another 40-50% of your money, into such funds. In terms of returns that a mutual fund can offer you, now what happens is there's a lot of benefit there. You don't have to independently do stock research, and there are mutual fund managers and who are professionals who are doing this for you. Given a long period of time, volatility will not really adversely impact you. So it's a very good idea to stay invested for a long term. You don't have to do research yourself. Your transaction cost is lower. So net mutual fund becomes a very beautiful vehicle to go and invest into over a period of time like you want to.
Okay, so since we're helping him, let's also tell him what are your top mutual fund picks right now. Which are the schemes you'd say he should put his money in today without thinking too much about it?
Right. Okay. Two things here. One, the fund history, about 3 to 4 years, if they've run, and once we've seen some consistent performance, that's one indicator. And the second is the objective of the fund. Because we were mentioning diversified and mid-cap and aggressive, we could look at things like Templeton's Blue Chip, which is a very good fund. You could look at Templeton's Prima Fund, which is another exceptionally performing fund. Reliance has a couple of schemes that are performing well. Birla's Midcap is doing extremely well as well. So here's, you know, some kind of choices that you could have.
Okay, these are some funds Ketan likes right now. We'll take a break. We'll come right back and talk some more to him and answer some of your questions. Don't go away. Welcome back. You're watching Your Money. We're talking about investment strategies today. We have Karthik Zaveri with us, who's telling you what to do with your money. And Sudhir Bailey has sent us an email from Mangalore. He has 2 lakhs in hand, kept aside to buy a house after a couple of months. He wants to know whether he can invest this amount somewhere to get benefits in the meantime. So he's looking at very short periods of investment. Where do you put your money if for just 2 months?
Well, what you do is then you're essentially talking about parking funds for a very short period of time. A good idea is to get into something like a floating rate debt fund, which protects your capital and also shields you from interest rate volatility in the very short term, because normally they adjust their interest rates on a quarterly basis. So that would also give him zero entry and zero exit load. So I think it's a good idea to get into some kind of a floating short-term debt mutual fund.
What kind of returns is he looking at in this kind of an investment?
On an annualized basis, you're looking at about anywhere from 4.5% or 5% if the fund does really well. So you just divide that by 6, and that's your return for 2 months.
Okay. What about other option? If he just parks it in a very short term kind of a fixed deposit or even a savings account, will that make too much? Will he get a lot more from a short term debt fund?
Not really. I mean, these are more or less, similar lines. Savings would give him a slightly lesser rate of return for a very short term. Typically you get about 3.5-4% on your savings account. Fixed deposits, if you can get a, 4.5 or 4.75 kind of a fixed deposit in a bank, even maybe that's an equally good option. But what happens is with a fixed deposit, if he needs to break it prematurely, if he suddenly decides in 1 month and 15 days he wants it out, he'll have to pay some kind of a penalty for that. So then the choice remains between saving accounts and floating rate debt mutual funds, the short-term floating rate mutual funds.
Okay, so those are your options if you want to park your money for 2 months. Let's go and see what Smita Bose wants to know. She sent us an email from Bangalore. She saves about 3,000 rupees per month and wants to know where she can invest it. And she's also asking if gold is a good option. I would have loved to ask if she wants to buy gold for herself or for investment purposes. But right now, do you think gold is something one should invest in?
Well, I was thinking on similar lines, why does she want to invest in gold? Because, she might be able to buy about 5 or 10 grams of gold on a monthly basis. I would say gold is an asset which may or may not give you returns in line with inflation, which is one. And if she has to invest in bullion, maybe look at silver or platinum. Silver maybe for its scarcity.
Can you invest in bullion with 3,000 rupees a month?
Yeah, I mean, see, if you buy gold with 3,000 rupees a month, you're looking at about 5 grams. If you're looking at silver, then you're looking at about 250 grams or 200 to 250 grams approximately, and that much money. But it's more of a hassle, I would think, to go to the shop every month, buy it, because you don't really have, with this kind of an amount, you can't do liquidated or like a DMAT.
So let's just assume for a minute she's not planning to buy this gold for her wedding and she wants to actually invest the money. You have 3,000 rupees a month, she's 24. Where should she put her money right now?
I think a value-based diversified mutual fund is a better idea, because I think she'll make far better returns there. And what she can do is, if she still likes gold, she could use some part of the profits over a period of time and buy the gold out of that.
SIP route for her?
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Okay. Thanks so much for talking to us today. Ketan Zaveri telling you where to put your money. That's it for Your Money for today. But we come back on Monday with another episode. Till then, happy investing and have a nice weekend.